Hey, I'm Decathlon Gamer, and welcome to a first look video for Pro Cycling Manager 2024, where we're going to be taking a look at the new features within this year's game. First off, I want to thank Cyanide and Nacon for this early access view for the key. The game is coming out on June 6th. New features have been divided upon two fronts. First front we're going to look at is the career mode, where we've seen changes in financial management. For this video, I have opted to set up a career with myself. Decathlon. That's me. Well, sort of. Decathlon AG2R Le Mondial is the sponsor, title sponsors. And this particular French team, the Decathlon part, is pure coincidence, as they share a name from me. They didn't steal it from me. Though, in terms of the world of cycling, I was around before them. But they, as a company, were already around. They just joined the title sponsorship rights with AG2R, as they were formerly known solely. But the team has picked up a second title sponsor. That's been a pretty popular theme of late within the sport, to have two title sponsors. Now, sometimes you have one title sponsor that is a primary, and you realistically have just a secondary or minor sponsor in addition to that primary sponsor. Now, in the case of Decathlon and AG2R, what you're seeing is we have a 50-50 split for the two sponsors, meaning they are both providing the same support. And this is going to be important on how this is now introduced into the game. Now that we have multiple sponsorships available, that negotiation process, well, there's a few things that come along with this new system. One, the divide of that role. That's also going to divide up what happens in terms of the objectives. It also creates a divide in terms of income. Likewise, there's also a divide in terms of regional requirements for your team. As most of you who are familiar with the game will recall, you can have high priority or low priority regions from your sponsor, meaning they want riders from specific regions on your team. And that is part of what's going to make them happy, make them content, or make them rather upset with you as a manager of the team. In this particular case, the Decathlon sponsor is looking for top world prospects, but they also want French prospects. And they also want to have at least a contingency of Belgian and Italian riders on the team. In the case of AG2R, their primary focus is on an all French squad, including specific regions. But new this year is multi-year sponsorship deals, a first for the game. Now, of course, it's been highly common for yearly renewals, and encoded within the database, of course, was probability ratings of sponsors sticking around versus coming and going more frequently on the AI side of things. As for the player, you always had a yearly renewal the day before you started your contract signings, and it was always an option to renew with the contract you had as long as you had maintained that sponsor confidence over the course of the season, and then two additional sponsors that you could opt to sign instead. But now, multi-sponsorship deals and multi-year contracts. Loving that part, but wait, there is so much more to this than just simply multi-year and multi-sponsors. Being that we already have a team with the multi-year sponsors and locked in for the coming year, it's blocked for us, but it's just grayed out, so we can at least see the basics of what is going on here had we not already had two sponsors in place. And you can see that there are multiple sponsors. There is progress in this prospecting tab. There is level of interest, there are updates along the way, and you can see there's a performance barometer that has to do with the attraction of sponsors. This is visibility of our team during the last 30 days for the World Tour division, and you can see the pie chart as it breaks out here with how strong of an attraction you are creating for potential sponsors. love that sponsorship is now going to be something that is fluid and changing. This adds such a huge dynamic to the game. But along with this new system, we have a totally revamped objective system, beginning with your traditional race objectives, but additionally, there's now long-term objectives. One in particular is seasonal objectives, winning 10 World Tour races for this present season, or finishing in the top 10 of the team rankings worldwide for the year. That's massive, because now we're getting into a full new dynamic on what's going on. We not only have variety, variations in the finances, but we now have a much more evolved objectives system, which is something near and dear to my heart for this game. Returning to the game this year, a much sought after feature has been negotiation of objectives. You now have 1 week at the start of the season to negotiate objectives with your sponsors, in which case it will impact the finances that you have, and it can and will impact your relationship, the confidence factor of your sponsors. Now, the key to these race objectives, for one, each sponsor has their variable important races. You get that opportunity to choose specific objectives throughout the season, which can be hugely important because many of us are going to have strengths in one area. Say you are a classics team. Your sponsor in years past might not necessarily care about those classics as much. They might care more about GC, but your team's not built for general classification. You're not built to win stage races. And so it can often be complicated on how that system worked. Well, now the option is there for you. There's a point system involved on choosing objectives, and there are requirements. You must fulfill certain conditions when it comes to choosing your sponsors. Specifically, you have to have 1 to 2 races per period, or at least that is what this sponsor is asking for. I do not know if this is going to vary sponsor to sponsor. This part might, or this might be general overall. I have not been into another career mode with another team to find out if it is different or not. But there is 1 to 2 races per period. The season is still broken down into 4 periods, with your first 3 months, your second 2 months, your next 2 months, and your late season activities. So you must select at least 1 race per period, and then you must have at least 6 points in terms of difficulty. You can have up to 10 points, and as you change objectives, it changes the difficulty rating. So that difficulty rating is going to play a factor in what you're doing. Here, the average difficulty of your chosen objectives translates the overall challenge represented by all chosen objectives. It does not take into account races, be it the Tour de France or some small unknown race, and is only a guide. The respective difficulty of each race objective will impact the confidence total that you can hope to obtain from your sponsors. So what you're changing out of going to winning 3 stages or top 3 overall is changing the rating score, the confidence that comes out of your different sponsors. And each of them is going to feel a little bit differently about the varying races. So finding some overlap that is going to impact them. But you see lowering the difficulty level and going for a variety of objectives, which you could see there's a lot more variety than there has been in years past. Another major change to the financial rework this year is the introduction of facilities. Monitoring our balance has become so much more important in the game, as we now have the necessity to balance our rider salaries, our staff salaries. We now have something to spend that hard-earned sponsor revenue on. Facilities now offer perks to your team to make them stronger, either temporarily or permanently, or at least in one case, as long as they are on your team. team-wide facility upgrades include a +2 on their cobblestone attribute. It's a costly upgrade at 30,000, but it's one that only lasts for the season. So making the decision to spend that 30,000 for that bonus is an expense that you have to maintain on a yearly basis. So it is offset. Would you rather spend that 30,000 on another rider, or do you prefer to get the bonus to the existing riders that you have? There's a trade-off in that choice, and that element of choice adds a lot more variety to the game. Now, likewise, there are other choices such as an optimization chain processing for 20,000. It's a +0.1 on all the primary attributes. It is a very slender gain, but it is a gain. Likewise, to go expensive for the second chain processing optimization, you gain a +2 to the primary attribute. So you can get overall a +0.3 at $70,000 per year. Also, optimization for ceramic bearings, 40K, with another potential +0.1 gained. They're costly. If you have a small team, you're not going to be able to afford these bonuses. You have to have money to play with in order for these to make a difference, because each and every one of these upgrades, especially these team upgrades, come with a certain level of expense that is hard to replicate in the lower levels. This now gives a realistic bonus to the big teams over the smaller teams, the teams that have the resources, just like there is in real life, where Jumbo Visma comes so stacked and in real life have world-class facilities. There's others that operate out of a bike shop, out of the back of a bike shop, out of the back of a van or the vehicle, and really lack resources, and they just struggle to go compete in races around the world or even just locally on a very limited budget. So the continental teams now can't afford to do these types of minor upgrades, and it really gives, even though it's very subtle, it's very minor, gives an advantage to the haves. That is something that really sets the game up for variance. That element of choice in how you manage your team. I really, really love this upgrade. Apart from the team upgrades, are rider-specific upgrades, 5 of them available, and they can be done on an individual rider basis. Time trial training bikes to give a boost to race day condition for time trial stages, individual and team. Molded handlebars for your riders can give a +1 to the time trial and prologue attributes. It lasts for 2 seasons for this one, but it's a hefty cost and it's only for individual riders. So realistically, it's something you would want to do with your GC favorites, even if they're not good at time trial, or a time trial specialist. Also, made-to-measure skin suits, giving another bonus to the time trial, lasting 1 season. Again, done at an individual basis. A bit less expensive, but also a little less bang for that buck that you're paying out. Here is an upgrade that translates to the entire career of an athlete. For this one, you put the athlete in a wind tunnel and get precise feedback on how the wind interacts and get them into the most optimum position to ride at. Now, this is something that I have heard is done in real life, so it makes perfect sense, but it's a benefit gained over their entire career by giving a +2 bonus to their time trial ratings. Finally, we have high performance tires, which is one that adds a bonus to the primary attributes. It's the only individual rider one that does have a primary attribute bonus. But ultimately, what you're adding up potentially for the base attributes, you can get a +0.6 to the primary attributes. Minor. It's a very, very minor gain. It's half of a point. But that half of a point can go a long, long ways for those who have really, really dove deep into this game and know the ins and outs, the mechanics, and what those attributes mean. A 0.6 makes a minor but significant difference long term. These series of upgrades can very quickly add up to well over $500,000, and then some. And so it's quite the choice that you have ahead of you on how you want to optimize your team. Contained within this mode is a few click option that really eases the burden of trying to micromanage this. So a little AI assistance can go a long way to help you out. But this is a wonderful treat to have. It's the bulk of the changes this year have been to the race 3D simulations. We're actually getting into the race. Let's start with a visual change and the introduction of the new race center. The previous version of this was simply a pop-up screen that went directly over the middle of your screen. Useful information, but
The base is rather
majority of the
slow.
time
The
you
runners
really
might be
had to
saving some energy for
pause
later.
the game
There's
to
another
see what was
rider on a
going on.
puncher. The sides of
Now,
the road are
it's
not
something that
tightest
can be
as front.
used side by side with you while you play the game and provides much more information than what was previously in older versions. For one thing, we've seen an evolution of the gradient mapping, which now shows gradients come with a color mapping that's different than the old one, or a little different than the old one. Road groups are also much easier to move, maneuver between, and follow, as you can see what is going on within the field. The profile has now been revamped with a option to zoom in with where you're at on the road. You can also maneuver manually along the route. You can see the
Some
zoom is
team
now
managers must
as
have
much
appreciated
as
the fact
eight
that there was a
times,
breakaway, given that the pack has increased
giving
its
you
speed.
a much cleaner look at what's going on both at present and along the way. The map profile has also been revamped for that same purpose with additional zoom compared to what you could achieve before. Let's see how we can really zoom in tight on this one, all the way to 15 times zoomed. Switching quickly to a stage race, the Tour of Australia, to help us out with the next component here. The Riders tab has evolved. For one, it's got a much cleaner look than it had previously, but now riders become easily identifiable based on their placements. So if you checkbox each of these point standings, you can
Pack
see
leaders
who
look
is
interested in following the
high
breakaway.
in those
Things have
point
slowed
standings,
right down.
who is involved in the mountain standings and youth standings, etc. There's also then, when you are not in a classic but in a stage race, you then get the ranking tab, which has a breakdown of the complete GC with the profiles still available, the points classification, mountain, young riders, and team classifications. Strategy tab is still present, and there's also events along the way. So we can see things like the fall that just occurred. Four riders are on the ground: Skelmoza, Thomas, Zana, and Nice. Geraint Thomas was involved in that latest crash. He is currently returning to the front of the field. Until I get in and play the game some more, I won't see just how impactful it is, because there is a greater impact from falls and
The Colo
punctures
teams have
this
set
year
themselves up as
than in years
pacemakers for the pack.
past. With three distinct changes to gameplay, let's begin with the one that has brought us here to Strada Bianchi. First big change is, in the past, gravel roads were only seen as a visual difference between that and tarmac, but in the game, there is now defined dirt roads, gravel roads, where we're going to see some variance in how it plays out. There is more friction, meaning like a cobblestone where it slows things down, it's going to slow things down here as well. It's also when you see some form of acceleration, it's going to stretch the group more, and you can really see it here,
Another
where
flat
the
tire.
group, the peloton, is stretched out quite a bit. Gaps do open much more easily than previously. You can also see here, from just a simple dirt slash gravel road, we are seeing splits. The peloton and multiple groups have split off from one another. we're really not going at a crazy high tempo, but it is impacting the race right now in a direct manner. Punctures. The rate of punctures has increased drastically over this terrain as well, which is all leading to more aggression. There's more reason for a group to put their foot down and push harder over a dirt road as they try to obtain separation over other groups within the field. With the introduction of dirt roads and an actual mechanic that functions on how it's how a rider operates over that terrain, one additional thing on how it's dealt with is what are the attributes that riders are going to use over this type of terrain, because it's not cobblestones, and so it is done differently. Now, the primary thing in real life that you are required to have, the primary skill, is agility. And with no direct agility attribute, what Cyanide has opted to go for is a combination of cobble rating, which is a very similar skill set, but it's also a little different. And they have included the use of the downhill attribute on how a rider will react, how they will function over the course of the race. But additionally, if it's a hill, if it's flat, if it's a mountain, they will use regular attributes as the primary as they go through there. That use of cobble and downhill is done on a minor basis. Developers have taken that a step farther by having that cobble rating, but also using that downhill rating along the way, but while still primarily operating with your regular attributes based on your surface, what your typical surface would be at that time. But the next big change to the game is flat ratings and protection. Recent changes to the game had required the developers to go in and boost flat ratings because other ratings like recovery, stamina, had been altered over the past couple of years. And what you ended up having was GC favorites couldn't keep up and therefore had to have a boost to their flat ratings, which wasn't realistic to what their real ratings were, just to be able to keep up, especially in the late stages of a Grand Tour. This year, those ratings are going back down to where they had been. So for example, Ben O'Connor has a 70. A year ago, you probably would have found Ben O'Connor to be about a 75 or a 76 flat rating. Now, the reason for that is this redesign of how flat works, but also the protection system. The role of protection is no longer just a simple on-off switch, and there are a number of variables taken into account on whether a rider is receiving total protection, which is more impactful than it had been in the past, or whether they are only giving partial protection to a rider. A couple of examples of ways that you would see riders receive less protection than what you would have had otherwise, or less than maximum protection. One, doing what Ben O'Connor was doing moments ago, and that is relaying at the front of the field. To relay, you're putting work in and therefore not getting fully protected. Also, as the group thins out more and more, the smaller the size of the group, the less protection that is being given to the riders because they're more exposed to the wind. So one of the keys to watch out for now, it becomes more and more strategically important to have riders supported than it had been in the past. This group is struggling a bit today, but you can see just how different this Strada Bianchi is to a typical Strada Bianchi, where it really comes down to actually really about where we're at right now in the field, where you would normally see some solid separations. That middle part of the race with the old system didn't do much of anything, and it wasn't until you got to these late ones where you'd have your classics guys really make a push and split the field up. This is one of those times where it's really good to have the race center to see what's going on. All right, Pantera is chasing. He's moving himself up the field. The last big change for the year has to do with sprints. For years now, it's been complicated because the game is built on a 1 to 10 scale. So 1/10 of the actual race distance is covered. And late in races, it's common to have corners. It's common to have corners throughout a race. But with sprints, it was problematic. Due to scale, corners were complicating how sprints function, and no clean solution was come up with. But what we're going to get this year is they have turned off collisions for the final 5 kilometers of a race. So you can actually bring your riders through, or at least the final few kilometers of a race. As we get into the last two here, our sprinter's already tired. He was out of position in the buildup. But with collisions turned off, you're no longer going to have those struggles. And the top sprinters, like Philipsen, are going to come out on top. The right sprinters are going to come out on top more often than not. I'm Decathlon Gamer. Thank you for tuning in to this first look video at the new features for Pro Cycling Manager 2024. This is due out on June the 6th. Can't wait to give it a shot. And if you like what you see here, please visit me at my channel at Decathlon Gamer on YouTube. Have a good one. Be safe out there. Bye for now.